Okay, so first of all, thank you very much for coming to attend this public lecture series. And today, I'm going to give a talk on how to make things invisible. So basically, I'm going to talk about the physics or the science underlying invisibility. So my name is Shuang Zhang from physics department at the University of Hong Kong. Okay, so here's the outline of my talk. So first I will give a brief introduction to invisibility. And then I will talk about metamaterials, which are kind of like supermaterials, which can control light in almost any arbitrary manner. So they can be used to construct an invisibility cloak. And finally, I will give a few examples of invisibility cloaks by using metamaterials or anisotropic medium. Okay, so invisibility has caught humans' imagination since ancient times, right? So they appear in the ancient Greek mythology, the cap of invisibility. You know, whoever wears this cap can become invisible. And also they appear in the popular fantasy books like The Lord of the Rings and Harry Potter, right? So they take a different form. Okay, so the question is whether this invisibility cloak have any scientific foundation. Whether you know they can be turned into reality, or they only can exist in you know fictions or science fiction, right? So that's the question. Okay, so before I talk about invisibility cloak, so I will try to say a few words about camouflage. This is probably the the closest thing to invisibility from nature, right? So in nature, you know, after millions of years of evolution, some creatures, they developed this capability to adjust their skin color or patterns to be very similar to the environment. Okay? For example, this fish, right? And also here you can see there's a toad. Although, you know, it's really hard for us to see them, but they are not invisible. We still can see them. It's just difficult for us to distinguish them from the environment, from the background, right? So this is not true invisibility. Okay, so of course, you know, I think some smart people, they engineer this mirror setup and claim this is an invisibility cloak. Here, in this setup, you can see, you know, this is a parabolical cylindrical mirror on this side and this side, so these two are symmetrical to each other, right? In this region, underneath these two pieces of mirrors, you can put an object, and that can be invisible. Of course, you know, it's blocked by the mirror, right? So that's not the important thing. The important thing here is that the light coming in from this direction, it can be reflected by the first mirror onto a focal point over here. Then there's a second mirror that can reflect it to the third one, and then when the light ray exits the system, it keeps remaining in the same course. Okay, it's the same direction and the same location. And therefore, our observer here, located here, you can see through this whole thing, right? It doesn't see the object hidden underneath this cloak, but it can see whatever behind it, okay? So is this a real invisibility cloak? So from here, you know, it looks, you know, it works perfect, right? Sounds like an invisibility cloak, however, this cloak has a very serious limitation. It only works for light coming in a very narrow angle. Okay? So if you know light going into different angles, it doesn't work. Okay? So this is not an invisibility cloak as well. Okay, so now I give another example. So this is also very interesting. Yeah. So probably you know a few years back, probably you have read from the news about you know this invisibility cloak created by a Japanese group. So from this video, so I've taken from the video clip online, you can see that you know this guy is wearing a coat, you know, look like a raincoat. And then if you look from the front, you can see through him. You can see whatever behind him, right? Yeah. Okay, so this looks pretty much like an invisibility cloak. Although you know you still can you know see the green color, the wrinkles, but at least you know it has the essential ingredient that you can see through it. However, if you are right next to him, you know, you will discover that, okay, you know, the setup is quite complicated. So there's a video camera right behind this guy. And the video camera captured the image behind him and transferred the image to a computer. The reason is that the image is captured over here, whereas the observer is standing over there. So they have different perspectives, right? So that will require a little bit of imaging processing. They have to, you know, do the transformation of the imaging to convert the image into, you know, this perspective. Okay? So after that, the image is transferred to a projector. And the projector is the light is shined onto this confinement and reflected onto the front side of this guy wearing this, you know, very specially designed coat. And this coat is called a retro-reflective coat. So that means, although it's not flat, but it has the property that when light is incident onto the person, you know, doesn't matter which angle it comes in, it always reflects back the same direction. Okay, yeah. All right. So that's the reason, you know, this observer can see, you know, the object, the environment behind this person, right? But this cannot be considered as a real invisibility cloak because this only works if the observer is standing right here and looking through this combiner. Okay? If it is standing at a different location, it doesn't work at all. Right? So this certainly is very different from the invisibility cloak in Harry Potter's movie. Okay? So it has this cloak on, and you can see whatever behind him, and it works for all viewing angles. It doesn't really matter where the observer is, it always works, right? So that's a know the true invisibility cloak, you know, we are talking about today, all right? Okay, of course, I mean, so what's the scientific version of invisibility? It's very simple. If an object is transparent, for example, a piece of glass, whether it's, you know, a glass bottle or whatever shape, right? Although it's transparent, but we still can see them. Why? Because the refractive index of glass is different from air. And therefore, when light is coming in, at the interface, there's both refraction and also reflection. There's very weak reflection as well, right? So by the way, you know, how many of you have taken optics modules? At least in secondary school. Yeah, I think most of you have learned about refraction index, right? So that's the reason, you know, we still can see the glass, the transparent material. However, the simple way to make it completely invisible is by putting it into a liquid. If the liquid has exactly the same refractive index as this glass or whatever, then the light will just go right through. There's no reflection and no refraction. It just keeps going through with the same direction, right? And then it becomes completely invisible. Okay, so that's kind of like a, you know, invisibility cloak. However, if you look around you, most of the objects are not transparent. They are opaque, right? So how do we, you know, design an invisibility cloak for arbitrary material, whether it's transparent or opaque? Okay, that's the way how you should design invisibility cloak. Okay, so here, the sphere in the center is where we want to put these things and make them invisible, all right? And then what we need to do is we design a certain material surrounding it in this shell region, okay? So this optical material can bind the incident light around the object in the center, okay? And then after they exit this cloak, they remain in the same course. It doesn't change the direction or change the location, okay? As if, you know, it just goes right through. So if one can design this kind of material, then what happens is one observer, you know, standing here can see whatever behind it, right? But not the person, not the thing itself, because all the light rays bind around it. There's no interaction. Yeah. So that's you know, how a scientific version of an invisibility cloak it should be. Yeah. Okay, so how to design this invisibility cloak? So this is based on something called transformation optics, okay? So this is first published by John Henry more than 10 years ago, maybe 15 years ago. So John Pendry is a very famous physicist working in the field of metamaterials and condensed matter physics. Yeah. He's from Imperial College London. So here you can see that, you know, if we can design a cloaking material surrounding this central region, the light coming in, they are bending around and then go forward, right? If it's a plane wave, you know, all the rays are parallel to each other, and then after it exits the system, it's also parallel to each other. Okay, all right. So you see, can the light rays just you know go out still like plane wave? All the rays are go straight through, right? No, not through. You know, they bend around this, just like a water flow around an object. Okay. So how to design this kind of material so that light can be you know bend around the things that you want to make invisible, right? So we can do this by using this transformation, okay? So let me briefly explain this, how it works. So first, in the free space, you know, we can design a circular region. We can define an arbitrary, you know, circular region in the free space. So here, you know, this gray color doesn't mean anything, you know, it's just our optical space that we want to transform, right? To make it into an invisibility cloak. But the property inside and outside is still the same, it's still air. And this boundary is not physical, it's just an artificial boundary, okay? Okay, so what do we do next? Is we're starting from a point in the center, okay? We create a tiny hole. And then we start to expand the hole, okay? Expand the hole. And compress the optical space around us towards the radial direction. So we compress the, we call this optical space, right? Initially, it's to fill in all the circular regions. But after we expand the hole, there's a hole in the center, the optical space is compressed in this shell region, all right? And then what happens is, you know, this one-to-one mapping. So every point in this optical space is mapped to a point in the shell region, okay? So for example, you know, any point along this blue line would be compressed into a point along this shorter line. Okay, so that means the optical space is denser now along the radial direction, right? So in this case, you can think about, you know, in the top case, right? Because the homogeneous media is still free space air, right? So light can go right through. But in the second case, because we compress the optical space into a shell region, so the light, they are frozen. You can think of, you know, all the light rays as frozen with the optical space. So correspondingly, they are also compressed. So they form this, you know, curved trajectory. But let's exit this, you know, as if nothing happens. Okay? So that's how an invisibility cloak is designed. But up to this point, it's still not clear, you know, how we design the material to fulfill this requirement, right? So it's still not very clear. Okay, so at this point, I think I saw some, I see some PhD students from physics department, so I can probably throw in some equations, right? Okay, so this is all based on Maxwell's equation, which tells us how the electric field and magnetic field interact with each other in the free space. And then, of course, you know, material have their properties, which is a manifested as you know, the relationship between you know this D field and the E field and so on. Okay, so based on these two sets of equations, we can basically you know study the field distribution or wave distribution in any arbitrary material system. Okay, all right. Now we need something more. This is called transformation of this. So that means we need to do transformation of the coordinate because we want to transform a circle into a shell. So there's a coordinate transformation involved. So that means we have to do this coordinate transformation. This is the Jacobian matrix, by the way. And then we can you know, do this. And eventually our purpose is that after you do the wave transformation, the Maxwell equation still holds. Okay, so format of the Maxwell equation should still be the same as before. Otherwise, it's not a physical system. So to satisfy that requirement, you know, we have to define a set of you know, permittivity permittivities relatively to the old one. For example, this is a mu, just a free space parameters. But then after this transformation, we can calculate whatever, you know, material parameters we want to put into the shell region so that it can become, you know, invisible, right? Of course, you know, sorry about this. It's just the only slide with the equation, but it doesn't matter. You know, if you don't understand it, that's fine. It doesn't affect the rest of my talk. Okay, so now forget about all the algebra. We want to develop a more intuitive picture how we can design the material to make things invisible, right? So this can be understood very simply by using geometry instead of algebra, okay? So let's see, you know, here we have free space. What we can do is we divide the free space into many, many grids. No, X direction, Y direction, Z direction, just to mark their location, all right? So this is a non-physical grid, it's just the grid, you know, for the location of the point in the space. Okay, so now we define this circular region in the free space, all right? Okay, so by the way, now when we define this, you know, what's the width of the grid? You know, what does it mean here? It means that within a very short period of time, delta t, we call it. This delta t can be extremely small. How far light travels along each direction, okay? So the length of each grid means the c times delta t, the light speed times the time, okay? How far you travel, you know, within this very short period, right? Because of the free space is isotropic, so that means light going along any direction should have the same speed, right? So that's the reason when we draw this grid, you know, they are perfectly, you know, a square. Because light going this way and that way, they have the same speed, they should travel the same distance, right? Yeah? All right, so now let's start the transformation. It's clear, okay. So let's do the transformation. What I did is I create a hole in the center and then I expand it to compress the optical space, right? And because of that, all the grids inside this region, in the shell region, they are distorted, they are warped, okay? And then this shows some resemblance to the warped space-time close to a black hole, you know, in the space. When you have a massive object like a black hole, it has a very strong gravity, and that can create a distortion of the space-time. They are not straight anymore, they become curved and warped. So that when light travels surrounding a black hole, you know, the trajectory is not straight line. It follows the space, you know, metric. It also becomes curved, right? So the underlying mathematics is quite similar between these two cases. The difference is that in this case, this transformation is due to the general relativity, the metric tensor. Whereas in our case, when we design invisibility cloak, we just use optical material to, you know, to do this transformation. Okay, but the underlying mathematics are quite similar in these two situations. Okay, so now when we stretch it, let me show it again, so you can see the procedure. So we start and then we expand it, right? All right, so how does this geometry tell us about the material property we want to put into this shell region? Okay, let's see. As I mentioned earlier, this distance represents the distance of light travels, right? That light travels within a certain time, delta t, okay? All right, so here you can see that after we create this void in the center, after all the grids are distorted, the grid now is not square anymore. They have all these, you know, funny shapes, right? They are stretched along one direction, maybe compressed along the other direction. Okay. So what does that mean? So first, we know that all the squares, they are now become a different, they have different shape. Really depends on location. When it's closer to the inner circle, it's stretched more. Whereas closer to the outer circle, you know, it's more or less like square, right? So that means the cloak itself first has to be inhomogeneous. Okay, you cannot just fill in some homogeneous material to do this. Need to be inhomogeneous. And then secondly, you can see that this represents the distant light travel, right, within this time. So that means, you know, light going along this direction or going along that direction should be different. You know, light travels around the circle or along the radial direction should have a very different speed. Okay? So that means this material should have different refractive index along different directions. Yeah, because the refractive index, you know, gave you the light speed. Speed over refractive index is the light speed in the material, right? Okay, so that means the material has to be something called a birefringent or anisotropic medium. Okay. And then lastly, we also see that, you know, when it's getting closer to the inner circle, this stretching is very dramatic. Okay. And the light speed here can reach infinity. You know, certainly, you know, all the light speed going along this direction is already bigger than the velocity of light in the free space, because free space is this size and this is much bigger, right? So now you may ask, you know, why is light speed inside bigger than light in the free space? Because if you're in your textbook, you know, light speed is the maximum in the free space, right? In any material, it has to be slower. However, the speed we are talking about is not the speed that the energy transfer. It's called phase velocity. Okay, it's the speed that you can think of light as the wave, how fast the wavefront moves. But this is different from the light speed or group velocity, which represents, you know, the transport speed of the energy. So it's different. So the phase velocity can certainly surpass the light speed in the free space. So that's not unphysical, all right? Okay, so it requires some extremely optical parameters, speed greater than the speed in the free space. Okay. And then finally, it has to be volumetric. So that means that we need enough room to bend the light around the object in the center. Okay. We cannot further compress. Of course, you think we can compress even further, right? To compress this region to be really dense. So in that case, you know, the optical parameters are extremely have extreme optical parameters. It will be very difficult to design. Okay. So we always need to leave enough room for light to travel through, okay? Okay, so now I will start talking about metamaterial. Because why? Because it's really hard to satisfy all the requirements with the material from nature, all right? So that's the reason, and I'm going to introduce to you metamaterial. This artificially engineered photonic structure, which can give us some very unconventional optical properties, which nature cannot provide us. So what are metamaterials? Metamaterials, by definition, they are artificial materials which gain their property from the structure rather than from the constituent material. So for example, if I use metal and dielectric, you know, we design some structures, right, based on these two materials, we can make metamaterial. And this metal parameter will be different from either metal or the dielectric. We can create something entirely new, okay? All right, so here, I put them side by side two schematics. One is a real material, which consists of these atoms, okay, real atoms. Whereas the metamaterial is similar. The only difference is that the smaller is the building block. It's not the real atom, but some artificially engineered structure, okay, which is much bigger than real atom, by the way, right? However, as long as the size of this building block are much smaller than the wavelength of the light, then we should not care. It's just like glass, you know, glass made of atom, right? It's not homogeneous if you look in, keep zooming in. However, when we study optics, nobody cares about, you know, how atom interact with light. We just care about the whole macroscopic properties we call refractive index. Okay, it's a similar thing here. Now, as long as the wavelength is much bigger than this smallest unit cell, then we also don't care about, you know, how the individual structure interact. We just can assign macroscopic property, such as refractiveness. So that's the reason we call this material also effective medium, continuous medium, okay? However, because of flexibility in engineering, the unit cell, we can treat very unconventional optic properties from this structure. And I will give you a few examples here. One is called negative index material. The other one is called super imaging. Okay, so before I talk about the electromagnetic properties of metamaterial, I first just talk about what nature material can provide us so that we can appreciate more, you know, about the metamaterial's exotic properties. Okay, so let's look at you know, the typical materials in nature about their refractive index. So air is a very close to vacuum. You know, vacuum is always one, it's a reference. And the water has a refractive index about 1.33, glass 1.45, and the diamond probably is has one of the highest refractive index in nature, right? At a visible range, which is about 2.4. Okay, we also have silicon. Silicon has a refractive index 3.5, but it's not transparent at a visible range. It's transparent as an infrared wavelength. Okay. And that's pretty much. That's the range we can get from nature, all right? Of course, we also have metals. Metals, the refractive index is dominated by the emerging part. So that's the reason it's not transparent. It's refractive. Okay, so you can see that, you know, this range is indeed not very large, right? We don't have negative numbers in there. We don't have a very large numbers there, right? We don't have something like n equals 100 or 10, okay? So this is very limiting. Range of referring that we can get from nature. Okay, so now let's look at you know, this most fundamental phenomena, refraction. Suppose you know, we have this pond, there's a fish, and we have learned about refraction. You know, the light incident from the water to the air, you know, is bent this way because the referring index of water is higher, so you know, the refractive angle is larger, right? And what we perceive is the extension of the light ray reaching our eye. So that means when we perceive, you know, look at the fish, it appears to be here. Okay? It appears to be closer to the water surface above its real location. Okay? So that created some kind of illusion, right? So what if we replace the refractive index by something with a negative number? Negative 1.3. So in that case, the light refraction, you know, the refraction angle should be negative. Okay? So that means that the incident wave and the refractive ray, it should appear on the same side of the surface normal. Okay? So that's a negative refraction index. Because of this, when we look at this fish, you know, it will appear above the water surface and then appear to be inverted. Okay? If we have something with negative refraction index. However, no, in nature, you never seen this because nature do not provide us with a material like this. Right? So this can be done by using metamaterial. Okay? Here shows, to refresh your memory, you know, light is nothing but the electromagnetic wave, right? It has the electric field, magnetic field, they are oscillating in the space and the probability, right? So this is a typical metamaterial operating at a microwave frequency. So it's quite large because microwave, the wavelength is a tenth of centimeter. Okay? So the unit cell here is millimeters. So it's much smaller than wavelength, but it's still quite large, right? So this material is designed such that, you know, you can see there are two components. One is the metal, this metal rod. And then we have this metal loops, right? Then you combine them together. So this metal rod can interact with the electric field of the wave, whereas the loops can interact with the magnetic field. So when you combine these two together, you can create something very, you know, dramatic, like negative index medium. Yeah. However, in nature, the problem with the nature material is that at optical frequencies, light only the electric field component interact with the material, whereas the magnetic field component doesn't interact. Okay. So with metamaterial, you know, we can design the material to interact with both fields. So that's the reason we can create something entirely different. So Yeah, so this is the first demonstration of negative material at microwave frequency. And then several years later, at that time I was postdoc at UC Berkeley. So we designed another material called a fishnet metamaterial, which is a multi-layer of this metal dielectric layer. Then we drill holes into it. And the size is quite small. You can see it's only a few hundred nanometers, right? So this material can function as a negative material at optical frequency. Okay, so we can scale down the structure. Now it can work for light. So here shows the experiment. So after we make this material, we cut it into a wedge, so like a prism, right? And then in the experiment, the light is incident from here onto this interface, and then there's a refraction at this interface. So really depending on whether it's a positive index material or negative index material, the refracted light is either on the left-hand side or the right-hand side of the surface normal. Okay? Then we can use a CD camera to detect this location. We can know whether it's a positive refracted index or negative refracted index. And then here it shows what we captured on the CD camera at a different wavelength. So at a certain wavelength, it's on this side, so that means it's positive refracted index at a shorter wavelength. Okay? At a slightly longer wavelength, about a wavelength of 1.5 micrometers, then we all observe the negative refractive index. That means light coming this way and that way, n equals negative value, right? So that's how metamaterial works. It works because the refractive index is negative, so the phase velocity must be negative. So what does that mean? That means that the energy flows. So from this simulation, you can see at a shorter wavelength, referring that to positive. So we launch a wave going up, and inside the material, we can see the wavefront velocity, is along the same direction as the energy flow, right? However, at a longer wavelength, when it's negative index, then inside the material, although the energy is going upward, but you can see the wavefront is going backward. So that's the reason give us this phenomenon of negative refraction. All right, so what's the application of a negative index material? So the first one we can think about is a flat lens. Conventional lens, we know that we have to make a curved structure of the transparent material to make the focusing light, to make the, can work as the imaging lens, right? However, if we have a material with n equal to minus one, we don't need to make any curvature, just a flat slant can serve as a lens. Why? Because when the light going at the interface, because of natural refraction, all the light rays is refracted backward, and then they can focus over here inside the medium, right? Then the light ray keep going forward at the second interface, they focus again. So you have two images, one inside this material and one on the opposite side of the material. So here shows how this material looks like. Still, this works at the microwave frequency. Okay, so another important application of metamaterial is for super imaging lens. So if you have used microscope before, if we try to use microscope to see very small things, there's always a limitation. It's called diffraction limit. So if you look at things like very small, 100 nanometer or 10 nanometer, which is smaller than wavelength of light, you cannot see clearly. Everything appears to be blurred under a microscope. So why is that? That's because the wavelength of the light serve as the smallest division of the ruler. Okay? So if I have a ruler, the smallest division 1 millimeter, right? How small you can measure things? You cannot measure things much smaller than 1 millimeter, right? It's a similar situation here. However, with light material, it's possible to image things even 10 times smaller than the wavelength of light. So this has been done by my former colleague, Zhao Wei Liu, now a professor at the UCSD. Okay, so now finally I get back to invisibility cloak, with my material. I will give a few examples. Just to remind you, the requirement, the requirement to of the material to fulfill this invisibility cloak. First, it has to be homogeneous, second, anisotropic, and then it also has to be, it has extreme optical parameters. and the speed much greater than light speed in free space, and they need to be volumetric. Okay, so here is the first demonstration of an invisibility cloak operating at a microwave frequency, right? So here shows the metamaterial. Okay, so this is an experiment. So in the experiment, you know, they make a metal cylinder, right? Then they launch a microwave, and of course there's a strong interaction between them. So you can see here, you know, there's a shadowing effect, right? Behind this, you know, the light cannot, there's a shadow after this sphere. However, if you put this invisibility cloak surrounding this metal cylinder, then the shadow effect is gone. The plane wave come in, and then after it transmits through this cloak, it's still a plane wave. Okay, it's not a disturbed. Okay, so that's how invisibility cloak works. Now let's look at design. You can see here, you know, they have different layers of this metamaterial unit cell, and they have different structures, so they are inhomogeneous, right? And secondly, you know, it's anisotropic. Of course, it's anisotropic, right? Because it's not spherical. So the property must be anisotropic. And lastly, you know, this structure is designed to have resonance. And this resonance effect can create very sharp response. That means you can create a very large refractive index, or very small, close to zero. Okay? So now this is satisfy all the requirements. So, so this can be, you know, designed to function as an invisibility cloak. However, there's one problem, that's a dispersion. So we know dispersion in normal material, like a prism, right? Violet going through this prism, it will be split into different colors. Why? That's because the glass, you know, the material, has different refractive index for different colors. Okay? So this gives us this rainbow effect. And this is even worse for this metamaterial because it has a resonance. Then that means that, you know, if you design the invisibility cloak to operate for a particular frequency or particular color, then slightly away from this frequency, it will not work. Okay? Yeah, it will not work. It only works at a single frequency. So how to solve this problem? Okay, so to solve this problem, my former colleague Jensen Lee, now a professor at Hong Kong UST, he proposed this called a carpet invisibility cloak. Okay. Of course, you know, there's a cost here. This carpet invisibility cloak cannot work in the free space. You have to put it on a mirror for it to function well. Okay. So here shows the mechanism. Suppose we have an object on top of a mirror, right? When light shines in, you know, it scatters light. That's the reason we can see the object. We can also see its image, mirror image, right? Now, to make this invisible, of course, what we can do is we put a curved mirror on top of the object to cover it up. Now we cannot see the object, but we still notice something is different, right? Because this curved mirror will distort your image. If you look in the mirror, that's how you look like, right? And you know, the mirror is not, something must be wrong. Okay, so finally, what you can do is we cover up with a certain optical beam material. So optically, it can transform this into a flat surface. That means, you know, although physically it's a curve, but optically it appears to be flat. Okay? So in that case, you know, everything looks fine. You know, both the carpet cloak and the object disappear. Okay? So here shows the three-dimensional schematic of this design. So the object, you have this carpet cloak on top, and now you look at it, it appears to be flat. Okay? So this is called carpet cloak. And for carpet cloak, again, you know, suppose we start with a homogeneous media, we define this area. Now we can do the transformation. We start from here, you know, we create a small void and push the optical space up, compress it upward. Okay? And then we design the material such that, you know, these two systems are corresponding to each other optically, they are the same. So inhomogeneous physical system corresponds to a homogeneous one, but with a flat surface, bottom surface. So everything appears to be flat. And this thing becomes invisible. And this reduces the problem of the singularity for the free space invisibility cloak. Why? Because in the free space invisibility cloak, we started from a single point, right? A tiny hole, and we expanded into a larger hole. So So there's a singularity created over there. A single point now is transformed into a surface, okay? So that's the reason we have infinite current closure to the inner sphere. But here, it's not, because we are transforming a flat surface to a curved surface. So the ratio is finite. So that's the reason, you know, we can make the material property with much less dramatic. You know, we can have a normal material to fulfill this requirement. So here shows the first demonstration of this carpet cloak. You can see here, you know, the colors represent refractive index. The red color means higher refractive index. Blue color means lower. Okay. So after you design this, you can transform this curved surface optically into a flat one. So you can put anything in here without being visible, right? Okay, so in the experiment, they drill holes into silicon. By controlling the density and the diameter of the holes, you can create, you know, control the referring that, effective referring that. So after they do this, they use FIB to, you know, make the sample, and experimentally they observe, you know, this indeed is transformed into a flat surface. However, the average is quite small. If you look at the scale, this is only 1 micron, right? So that means, you know, without microscope, you know, you would not be able to see the object anyway, right? So how do you make the things much bigger? So that's the work we did, you know, like 10 years ago. 10 years ago, and you can see here, we kind of make a simplified situation, yeah. So here, you know, again, you know, from a flat, with a free space, we have all the, you know, square lattice, square grids. And then we define triangular region. And then we do this simple transformation. We create a small triangle void, and then we compress the optical space upward, right? And now, what does this tell us about the material properties here in this cloaking region? Of course, you know, one thing we notice, it's homogeneous now, right? Because all the shapes are the same along this side and along this are the same, you know, but they have different orientation, of course, right? And then secondly, we also notice that this square now is compressed into a parallelogram. You know, it's stretched along this direction, but it's compressed along that direction, right? So that means that this material has to be anisotropic, or we call barofringent crystal, right? Okay, so now, for this cloaking material, it's homogeneous now, but it has to be anisotropic, we call barofringent effect. So in nature, we have some crystals, such as the calcite, which is barofringent, that has two different refractive index. That's the reason when you look through this crystal, you can see double images because of two different refractive indices, right? Okay, to confirm our design, you know, we use a ray tracing program to calculate, you know, how the light is reflected by this cloak. So here shows, you know, the light rays coming at 45 degree angle onto this cloak, and after it's reflected back, it's still a plane wave. Okay, nothing happened. And we also can change the angle to 75 degrees. It doesn't matter. It's not a direction dependent. On the other hand, if you remove the cloak, you know, only you have this triangular bump there, then it can dramatically disturb the light because, you know, this slope and that slope, they reflect light into different directions, right? So then here you can see, you know, how this cloak can cover up this one and make this appear to be flat, okay? So here shows the experiment. So in the experiment, we shine in a laser beam and look at its reflection. So here is a laser beam we shine in. And without the cloaking effect, you can see because of the two different reflection directions, this laser beam is a separated gap. But now we turn the cloak on, and now you can see that, you know, the reflection maintains the same pattern as the incident beam. That means, you know, although there's a triangular bump here, it doesn't matter. Optically, it appears to be flat. Yeah. So anything you can put underneath this become invisible. Here shows a further experiment. You know, we look at the reflection of a white lighter, a, you know, white color lighter, and you can see, you know, with the cloak off, the order of you know, the letters is a scramble. You know, we see CD here, but we see R here, right? Because these two specific side light into different directions. But when we turn cloak on, now we can see, you know, H to L, all in order. Okay, so the last question is, okay, so we can make anything underneath this bump invisible. However, we still can see the cloak itself. It's still a crystal, right? And it has different part in that as air. So what can we do about that? So finally, what we can do is we can immerse this into liquid, which has very close refractive index as a calcium crystal. And here we show the experiment. And inside of this liquid, you can see that when cloak is on, you can see clearly, you know, the reflection of this image is all the letters are in order. However, when cloak is off, then all the letters are scrambled. Okay, yeah. So that's the liquid make you know, this calcium crystal less visible now. Okay, so now that's my last slide. Just to give you some take-home message. So first, invisibility cloak is scientifically viable, right? Because you know, I talked to you about this transformation office. Everything is built on you know, very rigorous derivation. And second, invisibility cloak must be very bulky. You cannot have you know, Harry Potter type of invisibility cloak which look like a silk, right? That doesn't work. So it takes room to bend light. And third one is invisibility is dispersive. It only works for a single color or single frequency. Okay, it cannot be brought back. Unless it's a cupping cloak, but a cupping has the limitation that it has to work on the mirror. Okay, it cannot work in the free space. And finally, this thing I didn't talk about in my talk, but it's very important. Is that the person inside the cloak cannot see outside. It's dark inside, right? Because when light is going around, no light can penetrate in there. So how can you see outside without light? Yeah, so this again is different from Harry Potter's cloak, right? Okay, all right, so that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm very happy to answer any questions. Thank you. Yeah, don't be too shy, yeah. If you have any questions, please let me know. Yes, please.
Is there any research on the last plank you just showed about the person inside the cloak being able to see the outside?
Any research on that?
Yeah, I mean,
no,
answer
the
question, right?
Yeah, so it's impossible. Because, you know, for cloak to work, for invisibility cloak to work, the light rays do not interact with the thing you want to make invisible, right? Otherwise, you know, some of the light rays will be intercepted by the object itself. So in that case, you know, it's not invisibility anymore. So, you know, these two are not compatible with each other. So for this to work, light cannot go in there, and therefore, you know,
if invisibility were ever to become a thing, what do you think would be some possible applications in society?
Oh, okay. That's I think a lot of people have asked this question before. Of course, you know, people are talking about military applications, right? You know, the soldiers in the field, if they wear this invisibility cloak, they are invisible to the enemy. You know, that would be very powerful, right? However, one thing you know, I need to point out that this cloak is very bulky. Yeah, even you know, suppose one day we can make a large scale invisibility cloak, probably to hide you know object the size of a human being, probably need the invisibility cloak to have the size of a house. So it's not compact. So it's very hard to have you know. That kind of application, yeah. Yeah, I think, you know, some time ago, you know, when I was also asked by some people working in cosmetics, they are considering, you know, if I have this bumps on my face, whether I can, you know, put a cloak on and make it disappear, right? Yeah, but that doesn't work as well, you know, because, you know, it's too bulky, you know, it took a much bigger thing to hide something quite small. Yeah, it doesn't work, yeah.
Can you make for sound?
Sound? Yeah, yeah, of course. Yeah, I think.
What material be?
What material? It's kind of. I mean, sound wave and optical wave, they are quite similar. I mean, they are both waves, right? And therefore, all the mathematics we have used to design the invisibility cloak can also be applied to sound waves. And indeed, I myself have a paper talking about how to make a invisibility cloak for quantum wave. It can also work, yeah. So regarding what material, you know, I don't know, because I'm not working in the field of acoustics, but I'm sure, you know, there's a way to design it, yeah. Yes?
You just said if we use the negative index media, we can use the light with the specific wavelength to measure the size, which is smaller than wavelength, right?
Yeah, okay. So, yes, I talked about that. Super length. Yeah, super length. Okay. So here, super length can be achieved by using different type of metamaterial. For example, negative index metamaterial can work, but it's very stringent, you know, it requires, you know, almost lossless metamaterial, whereas in reality, all the metamaterial has a quite significant amount of loss. So here, the metamaterial shown here is not a negative index material. It's something called a hyperbolic metamaterial, which does not have negative refractive index, but it has very anisotropic electromagnetic properties. For example, you know, the permittivity along one direction is positive, along the other direction is negative. So you have a mixture of this permittivity component. Yeah. So this can work as a super lens. Yeah.
Oh, so just for example, if you want to measure a wavelength like 1 nanometer, so we can use the wavelength is larger than 1 nanometer to measure it.
Okay. So. The point here is, you know, by using this metamaterial, you can see things much broader than wavelength, right?
Yes.
That's because although the object here is much smaller than the wavelength of light in the free space, yes. However, when we design this metamaterial, the wavelength can be compressed. So we can compress the wavelength dramatically, you know, by 10 times, for example. So that's the reason we can see object 10 times smaller than the wavelength. Yeah.
Oh. So actually, inside the media, the wavelength is smaller.
It can be very small, yeah. So that's the whole point of, you know, using the metamaterial to do this, because the nature material, as I mentioned earlier, the refractive index of the average refractive index we can get is about 3, right, 2 point something. So you cannot compress the wavelength that much, only by a factor of 2. But with metamaterial, you can compress the wavelength by a factor of 10. Yes.
Sorry about that. I want to ask about because I learned that the refractive index of all things is mostly is the less is one, cannot be negative. I don't know. I don't really understand my logic why the artificial lens can be negative.
Oh, so why refractive index can be negative value, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So that's because you are reading a standard textbook, right? All those, you know, this field of metamaterial, you know, they are very new. They really give us, you know, something that, very new that go beyond the standard textbook. So the reason why with the, you know, conventional material, you don't have negative index material, that's because when I talk about this slide, right, okay. Okay, so light is electromagnetic wave. You have two components. It's like, you know, a person walking in two legs, right? You have one is electric field, the other is magnetic field. However, with all the nature material, they only interact with the electric field component. So the epsilon, we call it the electric permittivity. That's the electric response of the material to the electric field of light. You can change it, you know, dramatically. You can change it from negative value to positive value. However, mu, the magnetic response, is always one. It's the same as the vacuum. So you cannot change it. Right, so that's the reason, you know, you have a serious limitation regarding, you know, what kind of refractive index you can get from nature material. However, with the metal material, not only we have this, you know, component that can strongly interact with the electric field of light, but we also have another component that can interact with the magnetic field component. So with both, you know, in our hands, so we can design almost any arbitrary value for the refractive index. And indeed, for negative refractive index would, it requires both negative permittivity and negative permittivity. So if we have both being negative, then refractive index is also negative. Yeah.
So why is it that in nature there aren't any objects that interact with the
magnetic field? Yeah, that's a good point. So all the nature materials, they are made of atoms, molecules, right? They are very, very small. That's the first reason, you know, it's very small. It's 1,000 times smaller than the wavelength of light. And regarding the electric response and magnetic response, they scale differently with the size. For electric response, they scale with 1 over L. Scale with L. So the smaller the size, you know, it's a linear proportion to L, the smaller you have smaller response. But for the magnetic response, it scales with area. It scales down at the rate of L squared, right? So if I have an atom 1,000 times smaller than wavelength of light, then the priority, you know, the epsilon, you know, is proportional to 1 over 1,000, right? But we can have random effect to enhance it. But at least, you know, it's linearly scaled down. However, for magnetic response, it's scaled down by the power of 2. It's L squared. So that's scaled down, you know, they decay very, very fast. So it's 1 million, right, compared with, yeah, so that's the reason. All the nature material magnetic response is extremely weak. And indeed, in Landau's book, he once wrote, you know, basically at the optical frequency, magnetic property is totally gone. Yeah. Yes, please.
So it's very nice talk. So we mentioned this the near to zero or even negative the refractive index comes from the magnetic field. So I think that somehow that means the electric response will couple with the magnetic response. So my question is there any kind of the, is this related to the topological effect?
I'm sorry, what effect?
Topological effect.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
so you're talking about
in a TI, this the electric field can induce the magnetic response and vice versa.
Yeah. Okay. So you're talking about different type of magnetic material. So all the magnetic material I shown here, epsilon and mu, they are pretty much independent of each other. We can engineer each one independent.
Okay.
So this element only interacts with the magnetic field. This only with the electric field, right? So we can independently, engineer them. However, what you're talking about is the interaction between the electric response and magnetic response, okay?
Yeah.
So yeah, indeed, I've been working on that field, right? You know, we call it, this is called chirality. Chiral, you know, like our left hand, right hand.
Okay.
They are mirror image of each other, right? But you cannot superimpose them onto each other.
Okay.
So this is called chirality. So all the, in nature, all the chiral molecules, they have the property that, you know, electric response and magnetic response, they couple to each other.
Yeah.
But it is very weak. It's very weak.
Yeah.
But with metal material, I didn't show here, we can engineer this chiral molecule, chiral structure to dramatically enhance the interaction between electric and magnetic field. Yeah. So, yeah, indeed, we have used that for the study of topological photonics.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay. So, if no more questions, yeah, thank you very much again for your attention. Yeah, if you have further questions, yeah, just you can email me. You can find my website, university website. All my information, contact information, should be there. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah.